Now, the book of Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament, of course, and it's not only the last one in the canon of Scripture, it's the last one written of the Old Testament books. It was written about 400 to 450 years before Christ. Usually 400 is the year that's usually given just as an estimate. And that means that after Malachi wrote, there were no other prophets that wrote books of our Bible for 400 years. Actually, no other prophets ever wrote books of our Bible again, because the New Testament was not written by prophets. It was written by apostles. But the next prophet to come along was John the Baptist. And he was about 400 years after this. So we got a big gap between Malachi and the events of the New Testament. And these few chapters that we have here then are the last word that God really had for Israel, at least through a writing prophet, before the coming of John the Baptist and Christ. And so it's an important word. It's a short book, but it's got a lot of important things, including predictions about Christ and predictions about John the Baptist, but other things of value as well. So we're going to be looking at that. When he wrote, of course, the Jews had come back from the Babylonian exile sometime earlier, maybe almost 100 years earlier or so. The exiles had returned, and the temple had been rebuilt, and the religious establishment and the state of Israel was back humming along as it had been before the exile. One difference is that before the exile, most of the Jews lived in Judea, which is where Jerusalem was. But after the Babylonian exile, most of them didn't. Most of them never came back. And that is true to this day. The majority of Jewish people do not live in Israel and never have since the time of the exile. But in the time of Zerubbabel, we know that 50,000 Jews came back from Babylon, and they did reestablish the city of Jerusalem and the temple. After that, Ezra and Nehemiah also had ministries there. More exiles came back with them, smaller numbers, probably. And so there was probably a respectable population in Judah, though, the vast majority of Jews lived elsewhere. But the Jews back in Jerusalem were the ones who resumed the temple worship. And initially, they were pretty excited about it. The prophecies of Haggai and Zechariah, the prophets just before Malachi, had found the people receptive. People were encouraged to build the temple, even though the heathen around them were threatening them and discouraging them. And even the kings of faraway Persia were writing edicts about telling them not to do it. But the prophets of God said, go ahead and do it. And Haggai and Zechariah, who are themselves contemporary with each other around 520 BC, so maybe at least a generation or more before Malachi, they had built the temple. The people had responded to the prophets, a very rare thing in Israel's history, by the way, to respond favorably to the prophets. The Jews usually killed their prophets. Later, they would regret it, but the generation that heard the prophets generally didn't like what they had to say and didn't receive it well and persecuted them or killed them. But afterwards, they'd realize, oh, these were prophets of God, and so they'd preserve their works. Zechariah and Haggai, the prophets before Malachi, were unusual in that the people were positively disposed toward them and receptive and obedient to them. But when Malachi came, again, a generation or two later, the people had not become rebellious or idolatrous again as they had been before the exile, but they weren't exactly on fire for God. In fact, I would consider Malachi to be a study in lukewarmness. These people were still worshiping at the temple, and they were still seeing themselves as the people of God, following the rituals of their religion, and they were not doing what they had done before, which was to worship idols. They never did that again after the exile. So they were greatly improved over the generations that had gone into exile, but they were not exactly zealous for God. And this is what we find in Malachi. They had become lackluster. insipid, lukewarm in their zeal for God. And this is basically the message that Malachi has. Now, remember when Jesus said to the church in Laodicea, in Revelation chapter 3, that they had become lukewarm. This was not just a small problem. Jesus said, if you don't become hot or cold, if you remain lukewarm, I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth. Now, of course, to be vomited out of the body of Christ for a church is about the worst thing that could happen to it. It will cease to be part of the body of Christ. It'll cease to be a real church. It'll cease to be Christian. And so the lukewarmness of the church of Laodicea in the book of Revelation was threatening to cause it to be totally made extinct as a church. And Israel also faced that prospect. What we'll find is that Malachi enumerates some of the complaints that God has against the people, and even speaks of how they responded, which is pretty cynically and negatively, although they didn't kill him as far as we know. We don't know that they rebelled outright like some had done in the days of Jeremiah or other prophets, but on the other hand, they didn't, well, we don't know in the end if they got better, but by the end of the book, he's still threatening that the nation is in danger of being destroyed completely. The last threat in the book is that if they don't change, that God will strike the land with a curse. Now, some translations say strike the earth with a curse. The word earth and land in the Hebrew are the same word. The word eretz in the Hebrew can be translated land or earth. The King James, and I think the New King James, in the last verse of Malachi, refer to it as a threat to come strike the earth with a curse. Most modern translations recognize this is referring to a threat to strike the land, that is the land of Israel, with a curse. And there is a specific curse that was threatened in Deuteronomy chapter 28, that if Israel would break covenant with God, that he would curse them in a great number of ways. If you want to read it on your own, it's in Deuteronomy 28, from verse 15 on to the end of a very long chapter, God enumerating all the curses that would come upon them, including that they would be driven out of their land, curses would come upon them, it would stick to them and their children forever, it says. This would be the final doom of the nation. And the Old Testament's last words are God's warning that Israel is in danger of experiencing this curse, which means coming to non-existence, being wiped out, driven out of their land permanently. They had, of course, been out of their land for a while, for 70 years, but they'd come back because God had promised he would bring them back. But when they came back, he threatens that he'll drive them out again if they don't get it right. And after that, there's no promise of return. So this is what Malachi's message is. Now, in the last two chapters of Malachi, he talks about John the Baptist coming and the Messiah coming. And, of course, this would be fulfilled in our Gospels. And when John the Baptist came, he indicated that this is the very crisis that the nation of Israel is facing. When the Pharisees came to John's baptism, he said, "Who warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" Now, when we think of the wrath to come, we might think of, the judgment day and hell and things like that. But now this is the wrath that was coming on the nation, the curse that Malachi had threatened. And John said to his listeners, that the Messiah was coming. It says, even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. And every tree that doesn't produce good fruit is going to be cut down and thrown into the fire. And he's got his threshing instrument in his hand at the threshing floor. He's going to separate wheat from chaff, and the chaff's going to be thrown in the fire, though the wheat will be gathered into the barn. Now, what John is saying is, he's not talking about something far off. He said the axe is already poised at the root of the tree. It was not 2,000 years off. It was 40 years off. And this did, the curse did come upon them in AD 70 when God brought the Romans in to destroy the nation, burn down the temple. It's never been built since, 2,000 years since. It's still never been rebuilt. And their nation has never been restored. Now, I want to say this. There is a nation of Israel in the plot of ground where historical Israel was, but it's not a restoration of the biblical Israel, because Israel as a nation in the Bible is a covenant nation. That is, they exist because they're under covenant with God. They were a holy, special people defined by their covenant relation with God. And nothing other than that covenant made them different than the other nations. And of course, there are people, Jewish people, who've returned to that piece of real estate in modern times, and they've established it as a nation. But it's not a restoration of the Old Testament nation of Israel, because the nation of Israel today is a secular nation. In the Old Testament Israel, if anyone worshipped any other gods than Yahweh, they'd be put to death. It was a nation dedicated to Yahweh. Not today, it's just a secular democracy. Only the minority of the Jews in Israel today even practice Judaism, much less Christianity. And most Jews in the world today are either atheist or they might belong to some sect of Judaism, but they're not a nation in covenant with God. They are a secular nation. So there has been no restoration of the Old Testament nation of Israel, obviously. Now, this is the threat that the Old Testament closes with, and which John the Baptist at the beginning of the New Testament introduced as impending. So this is what we have in the book of Malachi. Now, the complaints that are brought against the people in Malachi are evidence of lukewarmness. They weren't cold in the sense of worshiping idols or just never going to the temple or doing, you know, not worshiping God at all. But they weren't hot either. They were definitely lukewarm. The word is not used in the book of Malachi, but it's the best word we can use. They were bringing sacrifices, but inferior sacrifices. They were not keeping their marriage vows. They were not bringing their tithes in for the support of the Levites. They were doing the kinds of things that show that they'd really lost zeal for God. In fact, they complained that serving God was an unrewarding thing. It was a wearisome thing. Now, you don't say that if you love God. If you love God, then serving God is counted to be the greatest privilege you could ever have. You pity those who don't know enough to serve God or don't have the opportunity to serve God. But these people knew about serving God, but it's a weariness, they said. Oh, what a weariness it is. And they say, you know, there's no profit in it. There's no benefit to us in it. So you can see that the people were not lovers of God. They were still going through the motions of the religious system, but even that they were compromising in. They were doing the minimum necessary. Now, this was the condition they were in. It's the condition that God said, okay, if you don't get this right, I'm going to smite the nation, the land with a curse. Now, when Jesus came, apparently they hadn't gotten it right, because the people of Israel mostly rejected Christ. And when Jesus spoke to the Pharisees, who were the most religious of the whole society, He said to them in John 5, I know you, that you have no love for God in you. Okay, so they were doing all kinds of religious things, as religious people do, but they weren't doing it because they love God. There must have been something else in it for them. Prestige, money, I don't know what. Maybe they thought, you know, God would have to overlook the fact that they didn't love him because they were doing all these works. But in any case, the nation was not recovered from the state that it had been in the time of Malachi, and therefore judgment that was threatened in Malachi, and which John the Baptist reiterated, and which Jesus, by the way, reiterated, did come upon them within a generation after the time of Christ. Now, there's quite a few problems that they had, and we'll see them as we go through. I gave you notes, and excuse me, what these notes do is they kind of itemize them, but I don't want to itemize them. I just want to go through the book, and we'll identify them as we go through. So, The word Malachi, the name, means my messenger. It's kind of interesting because the word messenger features in the book in a couple of important places. In chapter 2 and verse 7, he's rebuking the priests because they were not teaching the law. They were not teaching the word of God to the people. And he says to them in verse 7, for the lips of the priest should keep knowledge, and people should seek the law from his mouth, that is, from the priest's mouth, for he, the priest, is a messenger of the Lord of hosts. Now, Malachi was also a messenger, but of a different kind. A prophet is a messenger who brings, you know, oracles directly from God to the people, but the priests were also messengers because they were charged with teaching the law to the people. We have to remember that through most of history, there were no such thing as printed books. Books became you know, mass-produced on a printing press around the 16th century A.D., which means for thousands of years before that, books were written, but they weren't available for the average person to get a copy. They weren't printed, they were handwritten books. The priests had the handwritten copies of the law, and therefore they were to read them, learn them, and teach them to the people, you know, verbally. The people couldn't go home and read their Bibles like we can, but they could, every 7 years at the Feast of Tabernacles, the priests were supposed to read out loud the whole book of the law to the whole nation gathered there to hear it. And that happened every 7 years, which meant if that was faithfully done, then any Jew, by the time they were age 14, had heard the whole law written to them, read to them twice, although it might have been an infant the first time. And by age 21, they would have heard it read to them three times all the way through. And people had much more of a memory-based culture back then because they had to. You know, if you couldn't memorize, you just couldn't go back and look it up because you didn't have the books at home, didn't have printed books, and many people probably weren't even literate. So it was the priest's duty to make sure that the people were instructed in the law, that they knew what the law required. And in this respect, he says, they were messengers of the Lord in chapter 2, verse 7. Now, Malachi, whose name means my messenger, is a prophetic messenger. He does not appear to be a priest. Some of the prophets were priests. For example, Jeremiah was a priest. Ezekiel was a priest. The prophet Zechariah was a priest. Zechariah, son of Berechiah, and also another Zechariah, son of Jehoiada. He was also a priest. And there were times that God would take men who were in the priesthood and come upon them by the Spirit and make prophets out of them. But many of the prophets were not priests. They were just ordinary guys who, like I think Amos was a farmer and a sheep herder, and God called him to be a prophet. Isaiah wasn't a priest, but he was of the royal family or sort of a nobleman, and he was called to be a prophet. So once in a while, a person who is a priest would also become a prophet, but we don't have any evidence that Malachi was a priest. And a priest and a prophet, obviously, then are both messengers of God in different senses. The priest, because he conveys the written word of God, the established word of the Lord, and his duty is to make sure that the people know it. He's a messenger, like a teacher. He'd be the teacher of the law. A teacher is a messenger. A prophet is another kind of messenger, because a prophet receives oracles from God, timely oracles, what God's thinking at the moment, what God's complaint is at the moment, what God's requiring at the moment, that might not be gained just from reading the law by itself, which is, you know, the law is true through all generations, but God sometimes has something timely to say to a given generation, and the prophets, of course, are messengers in that sense. But there's two other references to God's messengers in Malachi, so there's quite a few plays on his name. But John the Baptist in chapter 3 is referred to as God's messenger, and so is the Messiah. In chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "Behold, I send my messenger." Now, we have no question that this is John the Baptist, because all of the Gospels quote this verse and apply it to John the Baptist. "Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me." That's John the Baptist. But then it says, before the end of the verse, in the middle of that verse, "And the Lord, whom you seek, will suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant." That's the Messiah. So, although it's a short book, there's four different ways in which the word messenger is used, including the meaning of Malachi's own name. He's a messenger, a prophetic one. The priests are messengers in that they teach the Bible, they teach the Word of God. John is a messenger who is both a prophet, well, principally a prophet. He was also a priest, by the way. John the Baptist's parents were priests. So he would have been a priest, except when he was 30 and would have become a priest, he became a prophet instead. And then, of course, the Messiah is also the messenger. So the emphasis is that God has a message, and he's got a lot of different instruments through whom he tries to get it across. Now, the book begins with the strange phrase, "the burden of the word of the Lord." Now, I know people have different translations here, and so some of the things I read, and I'm reading, it happens, the New King James, I've listened to the audio of this Malachi in 5 different translations today, and I was surprised how different some of them are in some passages from this, which is going to be difficult at points, because there's some passages that are pretty clear in the New King James, but when you read them in the one of the other translations, it kind of gets the message, or gets the meaning turned around. But that's not usually the case. But most of the modern translations, instead of the words, the burden of the word of the Lord, say the oracle of the word of the Lord. An oracle is what a prophet receives as a divinely inspired message. The word burden is used throughout the Old Testament to speak of what the prophets give. They have the burden of the Lord. And I guess modern translators don't figure that that word will make sense to modern readers, so they call it the oracle. But God is burdened. God has a burden on his heart. And he shares his burden with chosen messengers who are prophets, and they bear the burden of the Lord. It's on their heart as a burden. And they have to unload that burden by prophesying. Now, this expression, the burden of the word of the Lord, that exact combination of words is found 2 other places in the Bible, only 2. And both of them are in Zechariah, which is the prophet who's just before Malachi. Zechariah chapter 12, I'm sorry, go back to chapter 9. Zechariah 9:1, the chapter begins, the burden of the word of the Lord, which is the exact same phrase in the Hebrew. And if you turn to Zechariah 12:1, the first line is the burden of the word of the Lord. And then you come to Malachi 1:1, it's the burden of the word of the Lord. Those are the only 3 places in the whole Bible that expression is used. It'd be great if I could tell you why that's significant, but I don't know why it's significant. It's just interesting because only Zechariah, besides Malachi, used that expression. And Malachi, for some reason, is using it too, though the other prophets did not use it. Now, God begins in verse 2. I have loved you, says the Lord, yet you say, in what way have you loved us? Now, what we're going to find, one of the features of Malachi that's different than the prophets, and it's almost amusing if it wasn't so offensive, is that every time God says something to people, they say, oh yeah, prove it. They challenge everything he says. He says, I have loved you, and their first response is, oh yeah, in what way have you loved us? If you look at verse 6, he says, as a son honors his father and a servant his master. If I'm a father, where's my honor? If I'm a master, where's my reverence? Says the Lord of hosts. You priests that despise my name. Yet you say, in what way have we despised your name? See, they like to challenge everything. In chapter 2 and verse 14, it says, verse 13, this second thing you do, you cover the altar of the Lord with tears, with weeping and crying, so he does not regard the offering anymore, nor receive it from your hands. And you say, for what reason? Well, for what reason is still a challenge here. But they usually ask, in what sense are you mean this? For example, in verse 17, chapter 2, verse 17, you have wearied the Lord with your words, yet you say, in what way have we wearied him? In chapter 3, verse 7, it says, yet from the days of your fathers you have gone away from my ordinances, have not kept them. Return to me, and I'll return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you said, in what way shall we return? And then in chapter 3, verse 13, he says, your words have been harsh against me, God says to them, says the Lord. Yet you say, in what way have we spoken against you? So, I mean, this is a feature in this book that just shows what the attitude of the people are at this time. They're not stoning the prophet. They're just challenging whether he's really got a valid complaint. Yeah, in what way is that true? In what way are we guilty of that? He's making his charges. Now, most of the time when the prophets made charges against the people, they were pretty obvious things like, you're worshiping idols. You're committing adultery. You're, you know, stealing from your neighbor. And you never find in the earlier prophets, oh yeah, Where are we worshiping idols? Where are we committing adultery? Because it was obvious. It was something they knew they were doing. They didn't challenge the validity of the charge. They just killed the messenger because they didn't like being accused. But here, these people are not responding violently. They're just saying, oh yeah, prove it. Defend your position. And they're saying it to God. And the first time they say it is when he says, I have loved you, says the Lord. And by the way, God, you can see, even though God has got some complaints about them, and he makes some threats, he actually speaks to them quite gently and quite patiently, much more than I would if I were in his position with these people. He says, I've loved you, says the Lord, yet you say, in what way have you loved us? Like, we don't feel very loved. Now, maybe at this point, they were not prospering. There were times when the prophets earlier, especially the pre-exilic prophets, had said that when God brings them back from Babylon, he'll pour out blessings on them. And they expected to be prospering. They expected to have great, abundance of crops, great prestige as a nation. And these things hadn't really happened, not the way they thought. And so that's why they were now saying things like you read them saying in chapter 3, verse 14, he says, you have said it is vain to serve God. What profit is it that we have kept his ordinance and that we have walked in his as mourners before the Lord of hosts? They're saying it's vain to serve God. In other words, there's no good reason to do it. What profit is there to us in this? They expected something more for themselves than they've experienced. Now, of course, God is not slack in keeping his promises. But it's obvious that these people didn't love God. They weren't exactly zealous for God. Why should God zealously do for them the best things that he could do if they had been zealous for him? In any case, they're questioning. So you say that you love us, right? In what way do you love us? Why should we believe you love us? We don't see all the things we'd like to see. You're not providing for us all the things we'd love to have. And so he answers them. He says, was not Esau Jacob's brother, says the Lord. Yet Jacob I have loved, but Esau I have hated, and laid waste his mountains and his heritage for the jackals of the wilderness. Even though Edom has said, we have been impoverished, but we will return and build the desolate places. Thus says the Lord of hosts, they may build, but I will throw down. They shall be called the territory of wickedness, and the people against whom the Lord will have indignation forever. Your eyes shall see, and you shall say, the Lord is magnified beyond the border of Israel. Now, this is a very famous statement where he says, Jacob, I have loved, Esau, I have hated. And the reason it's famous is not because it's in Malachi, but because Paul uses it in a very well-known passage where he's arguing for God's choice of Israel, and particularly for the remnant, choice of the remnant of Israel, who are followers of Christ. It's part of the fabric of his argument in chapter 9 of Romans, and it's very often quoted, sometimes to the wrong effect, because people are missing his point. One thing I would point out here is that Esau is the name not only of the man who is the twin brother of Jacob, but it's also the name of a nation. Jacob had two names, Jacob and Israel. Esau had two names, Esau and Edom. In their lifetime, these two men were both known by both these names each, so they had alternative names. But after their lifetime, they had founded nations, and the nations they founded were called either Jacob and Israel on the one hand, or Edom and Esau on the other. The nations that came from them were named after their progenitors. So in later biblical books, it talks about Jacob or Israel, which is really a man's name, but in later books of the Bible, it's not talking about him. It's talking about the nation of Jacob or of Israel. Likewise, when later people talk about Edom or Esau, they're not usually talking about the man, but the nation that came from him, the Edomites, as we would say. Now, when God said, Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated, he's not talking about the men particularly, although it is true he favored Jacob over Esau, but that's not what he's getting into. He's clearly talking about the nations. He has treated the nation of Israel better than he has treated the nation of Edom. If the people of Israel think God hasn't shown love toward them, and that's what they're challenging him on, they should notice the difference between the way he treated them and the way he treated the Edomites. It's clear that he loved Jacob because although he disciplined them and sent them into captivity, he did bring them back and restore them as a nation again 70 years later. They had been taken into Babylon in 586 BC. 3 years later, the Edomites had been taken into captivity in Babylon also. They were conquered in 583 BC, just 3 years after Israel was. But they were never restored. The nation of Edom never was brought back into existence. After the Jews came back from Babylon and reestablished their nation, there were Edomites around, although there were just a remnant of them. And most of them had been conquered by the Nabataeans or Sabaeans and other, what we'd call Arab raiding tribes. And the remnant of those who had been descended from Esau now lived in southern Judah. They didn't have their own land anymore. They lived in southern Judah, and they were known as the Idumeans. And they were conquered by Jewish leaders before the time of Christ, and they became basically vassals. They were not ever restored as a nation. They were just a vassal ethnic group that served Israel. And God had said, when the two sons were in the womb, they were both twins, God had said to their mother, Rebekah, the older shall serve the younger, meaning Esau will serve Jacob. Well, that actually never happened in the lives of the two men. But it's true that the nation of Esau did serve the nation of Israel. And the last known Idumean in history was Herod the Great, who lived right up until the time that Jesus was born and died shortly afterwards. So the Edomites, they vanished. They're gone. God didn't let Israel vanish. Edomites and Israelites both went into captivity, but God restored Israel. He did not restore Edom. And that's what he's saying here. He's saying, I have shown love and favoritism toward Jacob. I have not shown such favoritism toward Esau. In fact, I've wiped out the mountains of Esau. I've laid them waste. And true, there are Edomites who would like to rebuild their kingdom, and they say, well, we're going to rebuild it. And he says, well, they may build, but I'll throw it down. In other words, I don't treat Israel and the Edomites the same, although they were twin brothers. And Esau was not necessarily a worse man than Jacob was. God didn't choose to bless Jacob and his descendants because he was a better man than Esau. In fact, that point is what Paul makes. If you look quickly over Romans chapter 9, because this is the place where this particular passage of Malachi is mostly remembered from, because Paul is more widely read than Malachi is by Christians. And what Paul is doing in Romans 9 is pointing out that the promises God made to Israel, which do not appear to have been fulfilled in the Messiah, because the Jews have mostly rejected the Messiah, are not unfulfilled in fact, because the remnant of Israel has in fact received Christ. The disciples, they were the remnant of Israel. The 3,000 converted to Christ on the day of Pentecost, they were the remnant of Israel. The Jewish church that was only Jewish for years after Pentecost, until the Gentiles started coming in, they were the remnant of Israel. The true faithful of Israel were those in Israel who received Christ. And what Paul is saying is, it may seem like God has made promises of salvation to Israel that have not happened, because most Jews are still lost, but God has in fact fulfilled them to the remnant. And he says in Romans 9:6, it is not as if the word of God, meaning the promises God made to Israel, it is not as if it has taken no effect. In other words, if it looks to you like God has not fulfilled his word to Israel, you're not seeing it right. It's not that it isn't, that's not really what is the case. It's not as if the word of God has failed to take effect, but they are not all Israel who are of Israel. And what he means by that is there are promises made to Israel, but not everyone who's ethnic Israel is part of the remnant of Israel. Now, how do I know Paul means that? Well, because he says it in plainer words a little later in the same chapter. If you look at chapter 9 of Romans, verse 27, he's quoting from Isaiah, and he says, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, the remnant will be saved. In other words, he's saying the people who are descended from Israel might be as multitudinous as the sand of the sea, just like God promised, but it's only the remnant of them that will be saved. God's promises of salvation was to the remnant. And you can see this for yourself. If you read the passages in the Old Testament that promise that the Messiah will save Israel, read them and you'll find there's many references there to the remnant of his people. He will save the remnant of his people. And what Paul's saying is the promises were never that the whole nation would be saved, but that the remnant would. So when you see most Jews reject Christ, it's not that God's promise to save Israel failed to come true. He was only promising to save the remnant. They are the true Israel, the faithful, who have the faith of Abraham. In Galatians, Paul says, only those who have the faith of Abraham are the children of Abraham. You can't claim to be a child of Abraham just because you have ancestry from Abraham, because Abraham was defined not by his biology, but by his faith. And that's why John the Baptist himself said to the Jews, don't say we have Abraham for our ancestor. He said, God could raise up from these stones children of Abraham. In John chapter 8, Jesus said, I know you are descended from Abraham, but if you are Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham, but you're of your father, the devil, and his works are what you want to do. So it's very clear that Jesus, Paul, they said, listen, when we talk about Israel, we're talking about the remnant. And God has, in fact, sent Christ and has saved the remnant because the remnant received him. Just like the remnant in Old Testament times received Isaiah or Jeremiah. There weren't many of them, but they followed Elijah. The remnant followed the prophets. And when Jesus came, the remnant followed the Messiah and became what we call the church, the Jerusalem church. And so Paul is saying, if you think God has not saved Israel as he said he would, think again. They are not all Israel who are of Israel. Not everyone descended from the nation of Israel are the Israel that God made the promises to. And he goes on to point out that Abraham had two sons. God chose one of them, not both of them. Isaac had two sons. God chose one of them, not both of them. And he's pointing out that within the biological family of Abraham and Isaac, not everyone was the chosen ones. Not everyone had any specialness in the sight of God. So that, he says in verse 10, Romans 9:10, and not only this, but when Rebekah had conceived by one man, even by her father Isaac, for the children not being yet born, nor having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but of him who called, it was said to her, the older shall serve the younger. I mentioned, of course, this verse a moment ago. It is Genesis 25:23, where God said to Rebekah, of the two twins, the older one will serve the younger. And then it says, as it is written, Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. Now that's from Malachi chapter 1, verse 2. Now, we know that the common way this is used popularly by theologians is to say, you see, God chooses who's going to be saved before they're even born. But there's nothing in Romans 9 talking about these people being saved. There's no indication in the Bible that Jacob was any more saved than Esau was, or that Isaac was more saved than Ishmael was, if saved means having a good relationship with God. We don't know that they didn't have a good relationship with God. That's not what that's about. God didn't choose some of Abraham's seed to save them unilaterally and others to damn them unilaterally. What he chose is which branch of the family in each generation would carry on the Abrahamic promise, which is to bring the Messiah into the world. The promise was that through Abraham's seed, the Messiah, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. That was an earthly mission that Israel had. God never mentioned heaven or hell to any of them. Read the whole Old Testament. You'll never read about heaven or hell. God did not talk to Israel about the afterlife. That's not what they were chosen for. The ones who love God, they're in heaven. The ones who don't love God, they're in hell. But he never talked about that, what he chose them for. He didn't choose a nation to go to heaven. He chose a nation to, on earth, produce a lineage that would bring forth a man, the Messiah, through whom all the nations would be blessed. That's what the nation was chosen for. And in every generation after Abraham, there would be one line of the family that carried on that promise. It wasn't going to be Ishmael, it was going to be Isaac. It wasn't going to be Esau, it was going to be Jacob. Now, this has nothing to do with whether these men were saved or lost. There's no discussion in Romans 9 about these men being chosen to be saved or chosen to be lost, but rather one branch of the family was going to carry on the promises, and the other branch would be irrelevant to the promises. That's the point Paul's making. Now, I won't go into Romans 9 any further right now. If you want my teaching on that verse by verse, it's at the website under Romans. But another thing about this that's arresting is the way it's worded. Esau, Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. Well, does God really hate people? Well, I guess he sometimes hates people in the sense that he finds them loathsome and disgusting and so forth. I mean, there are things the Bible says the Lord hates, including the Bible says those who sow discord among brethren, those whose feet hasten to shed innocent blood, those who have a proud look, says God hates those, it says in Proverbs chapter 6. There are people that God hates in that sense that we, just like I would hate to eat a monkey's brain if I was in India or something and they served it to me, I'd hate that. I got no animosity toward monkeys. I'm not hostile toward monkeys. I have no malice toward them. But I would hate that because I'd find it disgusting. There are people that God finds disgusting. But he doesn't have malice toward them because God so loved the world, everyone in the world, that he gave his only begotten son. And that's greater love has no one than that, than to sacrifice like that. God loves everybody, including Esau, and frankly, I have no reason to believe that Esau isn't in heaven today. He might well be. This is not discussed in the scripture, but he could be. What is being said here is that Jacob and Esau represented a crossroads in the family. There were only two people who were descended from Abraham and Isaac. They were Jacob and Esau. One of them was going to carry on the family tradition and promise. The other was going to be not involved in that. God chose Jacob for that. And there were many people who were in that family that brought the Messiah who were not personally saved. Many apostate kings of Judah, who no doubt died as worshipers of Moloch, still were in the line of the Messiah. So being in the line of the Messiah doesn't mean you're personally saved. It just means you're in that family line that's chosen to bring the Messiah into the world. That's all that's being discussed here. But why hated? Because in the Hebrew culture, it was commonplace to compare two things which you could not love equally and say, I choose that and not that. I favor that and not that. I prefer that over that. And in the language or the idioms of the day, they'd say the one that you chose is the one you loved. The one you didn't choose is the one you hated. It doesn't mean you had malice or hostility. That's just the way of speaking. For example, Jacob, we're told in Genesis, had two wives, Rachel and Leah. In one passage in Genesis, two successive verses, one of them says, Jacob loved Rachel more than Leah. The next verse says, when God saw Leah was hated, he opened her womb. But she wasn't hated. He just loved Rachel more than he loved her. But if you prefer one over the other, that's the way you talk about it. I love that one, I hate that one. Jesus said the same thing. He says, no man can serve two masters. He'll love the one and hate the other. Really? Do you really have to, if you have two jobs, two bosses, do you have to hate one of the bosses? No, but you have to prefer one over the other. If they both want you to work the same shift, you're going to choose one. This is my favorite. I'm going to work for him. This one's going to have to bite the bullet and do without me. I don't hate him. But Jesus put it out, you'll love the one and hate the other, because that's basically how they talk that way. Jesus talked about, if you come to me and don't hate your father and mother and wife and children, you can't be my disciple. It's the same thing. That's in Luke 14, but in Matthew 10, he said, anyone who loves father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves wife or children more than me is not worthy of me. In other words, that's hating. If you love Jesus more than you love them, that's hating them. Not in the sense that we use the word hate, but the way the Bible uses the word hate. So when there were two sons and God was going to choose one and not the other, he chose Jacob, not Esau. And he says, I love Jacob, I hated Esau. He's not talking about his emotions toward Esau. He's talking about the objective fact that he passed over Esau for the privilege of being, the family line that would bring the Messiah. It's not talking about God's emotions necessarily. Though he does have negative emotions toward sinners too. That's not what he's talking about here. He's not talking about the life of Esau, as Paul makes it very clear. The choice of the two, choice of one over the other, was before either of them had done good or bad. They're both in the womb. They hadn't done anything bad. And Paul's not saying, and he foreknew they would do these things. No, the issue is this choice was made without reference to anything they did and before they had done anything. Because it's not really a choice of God really hating someone like we would use the term, but the way it's used in Scripture, of course, God in every generation had to make a choice. Is it going to be this child or one of their siblings that's going to be the one? And the one you choose is the one you love, the others are the ones you hated, in the sense of the way it's used. Okay, so he says, I restored Jacob, I did not restore Esau. Therefore, that's the evidence I have loved you, as he said. And they had challenged him on that point. He says, well, look, Jacob and Esau were brothers. I chose Jacob. That's your group. That's your family. I chose you, not them. Now, verse 6. A son honors his father and a servant his master. If then I am the father, where is my honor? And if I'm a master, where is my reverence? Says the Lord of hosts, to you priests who despise my name. Now, much of this early part of the book is going to be addressed toward the priests because they dropped the ball. Now, they're also suffering for it because by the time you get to chapter 3, you find that the people are not bringing in the tithes, and the priests lived on the tithes. So the priests were going hungry because the people were not zealous to bring in their tithes. But this was a punishment of the priests because they were bad priests. In fact, in chapter 2, verse 9, God says to the priests, therefore I have made you contemptible and base before the people. Because the priests were so compromised, the people couldn't respect them. And no doubt that's why they didn't bring their tithes. Why should I support that guy? Why should I support these priests? They're worthless. You know? So he's made the priests contemptible in the eyes of the people. This has resulted in the people not bringing in their tithes, and therefore the priests are suffering the consequences of their own apostasy, or at least, if it's not apostasy, at least it's neglect of their duty. You're not honoring me. A master is honored by his servants. A son is honors his father. If I'm a father and a master, why aren't you honoring me? What's up with that? How can you justify that? And then they say, of course, at the end of verse 6, yet you say, in what way have we despised your name? Okay, so you're not honoring me. Let me tell you how. It's you can see it in the offerings you bring. He says, you defile the food on my altar, but you say, in what way have we defiled you? By saying, the table of the Lord is contemptible. And when you offer the blind, that is blind animals, as a sacrifice, is it not evil? And when you offer the lame and the sick, is it not evil? Offer it then to your governor. Would he be pleased with you? Would he accept you favorably, says the Lord of hosts? Now, when they bring sacrifices to God, according to the Torah, they were supposed to bring the most perfect animals they could. No spots, no blemishes, certainly no broken legs, no blind eyes. They had to give the best to God. That was written into the code. What were they doing? They're saying, well, I don't want to neglect going to church. I'm still going to go to church. I'll still put something in the bag when it goes by. Or I'll still bring an animal and sacrifice it like we're supposed to do. But hey, I've got this lamb over here who's blind. Or here's one who's lame. It's going to die anyway. Why don't I just take it? I remember a former pastor of mine used to tell a story about a man who one cold night, he went out to the barn and he came back and told his wife, wow, God gave us two calves. Our cow had twins. I'm going to give one of them to the Lord. And the next morning he went out and checked. And he came back and said, oh, the Lord's calf died. To give God that which has no value to you because you're going to lose it anyway. I lived in a Christian school that I ran for years up in Oregon. And it was a community. We had the dining hall. We ate in the dining hall regularly. And there was a weekly, a rotating menu for the dining hall. And I liked to fast one day a week at the time. And I would go and check the menu. I say, well, what day do I want to fast? Oh, they're having, oh, yeah, that's my fast day, you know. I did that for a short time, and I realized, wait a minute, I'm offering God the blind and the lame, you know. If I'm going to fast, it's unto the Lord. It's making a sacrifice for his sake. But if what I'm sacrificing is a meal I didn't even like anyway, and I wouldn't have eaten, then am I killing two birds with one stone? No, I'm killing no birds at all. God knows I'm offering up to him what costs me nothing. I should pick the day that has the food I like the most and say, that's going to be my fast day. And same thing with, you give God the best. if you give them anything. And this is what they weren't doing. And this is the first mark of being lukewarm. They have not given up being worshipers of God. They've just given up on zealously worshiping God, sacrificially working. They still bring their sacrifices, but they bring sacrifices that are the least expensive to them, the ones that are going to die anyway, the ones that are no use to them. And I think that Christians often do that too. They still attend church. They still put a little something in the bag when it goes by. By the way, we don't pass bags here, but most churches do, of course. And yet they do, in many cases. You can tell your love is growing cold when you're not wanting to give God the best. It's not that you don't want to give God anything, but you don't want your worship of God to impinge on your own interests too much. And if you've got a blind sheep, why not give that one? Well, why not? Because God's offended. He says, give that to your governor. Will he like that? You bring a gift to your governor, you bring him your blind sheep. See what he thinks about that. Is he going to favor you for that? I don't think so. And yet you bring that to God. Verse 9. But now entreat God's favor that he may be gracious to us. While this is being done by your hands, will he accept you favorably? Says the Lord of hosts. Who is there among you who would shut the doors, meaning of the temple, so that you would not kindle the fire on my altar in vain? I have no pleasure in you, says the Lord of hosts. Now, when he says, who is there even among you who would shut the doors? Most of the other translations I read today said, oh, that somebody would shut the doors. Meaning they'd shut off, they'd just close the temple down, bolt the doors, nail up boards, don't let anyone in, so that they will stop bringing these sacrifices that dishonor God. I wish someone would just shut the doors, don't light the fire on the altar, just don't bring these vain sacrifices because I'm not accepting them. I'm not pleased with them. Might as well not even have the temple. Might as well not worship God if that's how you're going to do it. That's what he's saying. He says in this 11, for from the rising of the sun, even to its going down, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. In every place, incense shall be offered to my name, and a pure offering, for my name shall be great among the nations, says the Lord of hosts. Now, the statement from the rising of the sun to the going down of it, we probably think that means from sunrise in the morning till evening, so all day long. But actually, in the Old Testament, that's not how they talk. The rising of the sun is a Hebrew idiom for the east. And the going down of the sun is a Hebrew idiom for the west. It's a direction, not a time of the day. In fact, you'll even find times in the Old Testament where it talks about from the east even to the going down of the sun. Or it'll say from the rising of the sun even to the west. You see, obviously, the rising of the sun just means the east. The going down of the sun means the west. So he's saying all over the world. He's not talking about all day long from sunrise to sundown. He's saying, the world over, from the east to the west, my name will be great among the Gentiles. My name will be praised among the heathen. Now, this is a very important statement. Because one of the themes of the Bible frequently in the prophets and certainly in the New Testament is that where the Jews often drop the ball with reference to their zeal and service of God, the Gentiles often would pick it up. When a Gentile came to Jesus and said, I know you want to heal my servant, but don't come to my house because I'm not worthy to have you under my house. You just give the command. I know that it'll be done. Jesus said, I haven't found this kind of faith in all of Israel. Here's a Gentile who's got more faith than any of the Jews have. And that's a very common theme in the New Testament. In Romans chapter 2, Paul's rebuking Jews. He says, you say you're a Jew, you boast in the law, but here's some Gentiles who keep the law better than you do. You say that men ought not to commit adultery, but do you commit adultery? You say that people shouldn't steal, but do you steal? You say that people shouldn't do this, but you're doing it. But these Gentiles over here, meaning the Christian Gentiles, they're living up to the code that you say people should live up to, and you're not. And so it's very clear, even Jesus said to Israel, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation that will bring forth the fruits of it. The idea of the prophets and Jesus is often that the Jews, they're apathetic about God. whereas many Gentiles would be excited about God. And that's what it's saying here. You guys are apathetic. Yeah, you still come to the temple. Yeah, you offer these worthless animals just so you're doing something. But the world over, the nations, my name's going to be great among the nations. The pagans, they'll have a different attitude than you. It says, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. In every place, incense shall be offered to my name and a pure offering. You know, there's an early church document called the Didache. If you've listened to me, you may have heard me quote from it before, because it's one of the most ancient documents outside of the New Testament itself from the early church. Came out right around the year 100 AD, so like a generation after the apostles, and it's a document of church order. But it's interesting, in the Didache, in chapter 14 of the Didache, we have this statement. But every Lord's Day, gather yourselves together and break bread and give thanksgiving after having confessed your transgressions, that your sacrifice may be pure. For this is that which was spoken by the Lord. In every place, incense shall be offered to my name and a pure offering. In other words, he quotes this passage from Malachi. And the Didache says, when we come together and worship God, when we offer our thanksgiving to God, this is a fulfillment of Malachi's prediction that among the Gentiles, God's name would be honored. They would offer up incense to his name. Now, in the book of Revelation, the prayers of the saints is likened to incense in Revelation 5:8. And again in chapter 8, I think it's verse 3. And over in Hebrews, it talks about the offerings that we offer up as a holy priesthood. In Hebrews chapter 13, it says in Hebrews 13, verse 15, therefore by him let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. So we, as a spiritual priesthood, offer up spiritual sacrifices, our praise to God, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. Well, that's the Gentiles, us, the world over, the church, the world over, is honoring God, honoring Christ, offering up praise and offerings and our sacrifice to him in that sense. And so Malachi is predicting the results of the coming of Christ and the Gentiles coming to Christ. But it says in verse 12, Malachi 1:12, but you profane it in that you say the table of the Lord is defiled and its food is contemptible. You also say, oh, what a weariness. As they find it a weariness to have to go and do these rituals and serve God. What a burden it is. And you sneer at it, says the Lord of hosts. And you bring the stolen, the lame, the sick, meaning defective animals. Thus you bring an offering, exclamation point. Should I accept this from your hand, says the Lord? But cursed be the deceiver who has in his flock a male and makes a vow, but sacrifices to the Lord what is blemished. For I am a great king, says the Lord of hosts, and my name shall be feared among the nations, that is, among the Gentiles. A curse upon the man who's got a qualified animal to offer for sacrifice, and he vows to give a sacrifice to God, but instead of bringing the qualified animal, he brings a defective animal. There's a curse on him for that. But he says that's not what the Gentiles will do. Well, some of them probably do, actually, but I mean, there are Christian Gentiles who are no more, who are every bit as lukewarm as the Jews were at this time. But certainly, he's saying the real worship, the real zealous worship, the real true heartfelt worship is going to come largely from the Gentiles. Not that the Jews are left out, because many Jews have followed Christ too and are zealous for Christ. But certainly, as you look at the demographics of the people of God throughout the world, it's more Gentiles than Jews. Partly because there's more Gentiles in the world than there are Jews, and therefore the cross-section that have come to Christ are more Gentile than Jews. So God's receiving honor from Gentiles, which he did not receive from his own people in some cases. Now, chapter 2, you know what? Instead of going to chapter 2, I'm going to take a break, because I would have liked to take this in one session, but it's going to take more, obviously. We gave an introduction that took up more time than the rest of the chapter is going to take up. So why don't we take a stretch break?